Okay. So this is on WireGuard, which is a new VPN tunnel for Linux that lives in the kernel and should hopefully be seeing some usage inside LinuxKit. So background about me, some of you might know me as ZX54. My background is in exploitation and kernel vulns and crypto vulns and some development stuff. And I wanted to make a VPN that would avoid the problems in crypto and in implementation that I've seen when breaking other projects. So from the beginning, the whole thing is kind of motivated by an offensive concern. The protocol and the project itself stemmed out of a rootkit I was working on that needed to be stealthy and have a variety of security properties. I wound up turning that rootkit into something people could actually use as a VPN. So what is WireGuard? It's a layer 3 secure network tunnel for V4 and V6. And the design of it is very opinionated. There are very few knobs to turn and not many settings. There's not a lot that you can configure. So for example, it's layer 3 IP and not layer 2 Ethernet. And it will never support Ethernet, even though that wouldn't be a very difficult change because that's just not the right way to set up network tunnels. So there are a lot of decisions like this that are kind of already made. It lives in the Linux kernel, so it's really low level in the network stack, which means it's fast and well integrated. But there are also some cross-platform implementations that are being worked on right now. There's a Go implementation that I'm working on with a Google Summer Code student. Someone's working on a Rust implementation, another person on a Haskell implementation. It's UDP-based, which means it works on the internet. These days on the internet, you can really only send UDP traffic or TCP traffic to other protocols. So it encapsulates network traffic inside of UDP. The crypto in it uses a so-called modern crypto, but still conservative crypto. It uses elliptic curve cryptography, not say traditional RSA or traditional finite field Diffie-Hellman. But it's conservative, so it doesn't make too modern, too funky choices. The general emphasis is on making everything super simple and super auditable. So as we'll see in a sec, we try and keep the code base simple, the design simple. And likewise, the authentication model is extremely simple. It's supposed to be a little bit like the authenticated keys in SSH, where both sides exchange their public keys and these short strings, then they can talk to each other. So no certificate authorities, no signing, just kind of really basic SSH authenticated keys model. And more generally, it's trying to be a replacement for OpenVPN and for IPsec. Both are kind of legacy projects from the 90s and need a healthy updating. So as I mentioned before, the code base is really small. OpenVPN is like 100,000 lines of code, plus OpenSSL for all the crypto. Linux XFRM is 13,000 lines of code, but that's just for the symmetric crypto. You also need a key exchange, something like StrongSwan, which has another 400,000 lines of code. Soft Ether is this crazy Japanese project that kind of implements a bunch of different VPN protocols, and it's 300,000 lines of code. And with projects like these, you're just never going to be able to read all that code and audit it and be sure that it's correct. Whereas WireGuard is less than 4,000 lines of code. So probably everyone in this call can read the whole code base in the afternoon, understand it, and either find bugs to fix or be reasonably sure that there aren't bugs because it's just a small, easy thing. So visualizing that in the planet of VPNs, WireGuard is clearly Pluto. So as I mentioned, the emphasis is on the simplicity of the interface. So with WireGuard, you get a normal network interface. And so you use all the same tools that you ordinarily know from networking. So to add an interface, you use IP link add. If you want to give an IP address, use IP address add, add route, IP route. If you don't like the new IP tools in Linux, you can use ifconfig just like you used to. It works with IP tables in a reasonable way. You can even use /host and bind. And so everything that you normally do with a network interface like ETH0 or WLAN0 can work with WireGuard, which would be WG0. So it doesn't add a new layer of networking like, say, IPsec does with its transformation layer. You just get an interface, so really basic integration to everything that's already there. But WireGuard is really blasphemous. We break a lot of the layering assumptions that came out in the 90s about how you should do secure tunneling. So with IPsec, you have this transformation table for outgoing packets, which hooks up to a security policy and a separate user space daemon doing key exchange and talking to the kernel and all of the state spread out and all over the place. And on paper, this is kind of very nice and academically pristine. But in practice, something like this is just enormously complex. So get rid of all these different layerings that are theoretically nice, but in practice not, and I just kind of smush everything down. So with WireGuard, as I mentioned, you get the network interface as the basic building block, and then we build up from there. So by trying to choose something where you just have the interface, where you put it all into one thing, there are contradictions. You're not supposed to break layering assumptions. But I found for each of the contradictions that smushing this all together creates, there's been a really good engineering solution to get around the contradiction. So kind of starting with something that should be broken, we're able to actually find really elegant solutions for putting it all back together. So it is just an interface like ETH0 or WLAN0, but it's doing crypto. And ordinarily, crypto needs concepts of a connection that's happened, of state, we exchange keys, what's going on with the interface. But with WireGuard, we actually hide all of that. So the WG0 interface still looks stateless to the system administrator. You just send packets and it seems to work. But behind the scenes, there's a lot of things going on to actually do the key exchange and all the rest. So in a bit, we'll see how that all works. So essentially you add an interface, you configure the different peers that it's going to talk to, and then you can just start sending packets. If any of you have ever used Mosh, you might be familiar with this concept of roaming. What this means is that you can start using WireGuard from Wi-Fi and then switch to another Wi-Fi network, and the connection will just continue to work, switch to a LTE or a 3G network, and it'll just keep working, put your laptop to sleep in one place, open it up to another, and it'll still be connected. So you're able to kind of move around between different IP addresses really flawlessly. So this is very convenient, especially for kind of dynamic setups. As we mentioned before, the authentication is kind of similar to SSH's authenticated keys, where the identity in WireGuard is just a static public key, which in our case is just a 32-byte base64 string. So 44 characters of base64, really simple. So everything else, like the session state and connections and all that, is invisible. So once you set it up, you just use it and you don't have to care about all the other stuff. So very basic there. So the thing that lets us break all these layering assumptions is this concept of crypto key routing. So this is where we have an association between a public key of a peer and the IP addresses that a peer is allowed to be. So within a layer 3 tunnel, we are talking to another computer on the internet. So this is like an external IP, an internet IP. But within the tunnel, we have another IP packet, which itself has like an internal IP. And this internal IP is bound to a public key of a peer. So you have a one-to-one mapping between a peer appears public key and the IP address that that peer is allowed to look like inside the tunnel. So how does this play out? A WireGuard interface has its own private key. It has a UDP port that it listens on and a list of the peers that it's going to talk to. And then each peer is identified by this public key, has a list of these allowed IPs that it's allowed to be inside the tunnel. And it optionally has an endpoint IP and port. That is, if you want to talk to that peer, where do you find it on the internet? Now, it's optional because WireGuard is roaming, as I mentioned. So if you don't specify an endpoint, then it'll just automatically determine the endpoint the first time it receives an authenticated packet from that peer. So the fundamental concept is this one-to-one mapping between the public key of a peer and the IP address inside the tunnel. So this concept of crypto key routing makes system administration super simple. You can kind of imagine the firewall rules immediately, where if it comes from an interface of WG0 and it's from this particular IP address, then it definitely came from, say, Yoshi, who's been assigned the IP in WireGuard. It couldn't have come from anyone else. And it's definitely authenticated and it's definitely encrypted. And you only have to check for these two criteria: did it come from WireGuard interface, and is it from the IP address? So this allows all sorts of super rudimentary authentication schemes to actually work again. You know, you're not supposed to rely on an IP address for someone's identity, but if it's coming from a WireGuard tunnel, you can. So within your applications, you don't even have to be caring about public keys or identities or crypto. You can just use the same identifier that you would otherwise be using. So, again, this is another one of these kind of tricks that we use so that we can kind of put together again the layering violations we make by smushing everything together. With something like crypto key routing, it becomes really easy. So before I go further with how this all works, I think I'll give a demo. I've just had to set two things up so you can kind of imagine what the commands look like. But before I do a demo, are there any questions so far on this? Okay, some demo time. Okay, so we have peer A on the left and peer B on the right. So let's play this. So we generate a private key on each side. So you notice that this is just a very simple Unix command line tool, wggenkey. It spits out a random private key on standard output that then we put in the file, and as basic as it could get. When we look at it, we see that it's just this base64 encoded private key. Then we can derive a public key from a private key by sending, go a little bit fast. We can derive the public key from the private key by just giving to WG pub key the private key on standard input, and then it derives the public key on standard output. So like just the most basic command line interface you can imagine, but then this makes it easily composable, you can use scripts, etc. Okay, so now we actually add the WireGuard interface. So IP link at WG0, we give this, this interface an IP address. So this is the IP address within the tunnel because it's for WG0. Then we give that interface the private key that we just generated and we set it up. And now we'll do the same thing on peer B. We add the interface to WG0. We're gonna give it an IP address inside the tunnel. We now tell it, here's the private key that we just generated, and we set it up. Okay, so now when we hit IP address, we see that we have multiple interfaces. We have ETH0, this is sort of our internet facing interface, a normal Ethernet. And that's in the 192.168.1.whatever. So this will be the external IPs. Then for WG0, we have this this 10.0.0.whatever IP address, and this is inside the tunnel. So now when we hit WG, we see the current information. There's a public key and a private key, and they both listed on the particular port. And so now we can tell peer A about the public key of peer B. And here the way of exchanging the long-term static keys was just with copy and paste from one thing to another. But you can imagine we're using this in some other infrastructure. You would have a different wrapper around it. If you were to use it in Docker, you'd have the Docker orchestration mechanisms kind of giving these out. And because this is such kind of a basic, simple building block, you can really combine it with any other thing you're already using. LDAP, if you're into that, DNSSEC and Dane, if you're insane, just kind of anything you're used to using. If you like Java enterprise garbage, you could use that. If you like nice TLS REST APIs, you can do that. But in this case, we're just setting up two peers, so we just copy and paste from one to another. So we tell peer A about peer B's public key, and we say that peer B is allowed to be that IP address inside the tunnel, 10.0.0.2, and the endpoint defined on the internet is 192.168.1.2 on port 51820. So we do the same thing on the other side. We tell now peer B about peer A's public key, and we say that the IPs that peer B is allowed to be inside the tunnel is just this one, 10.0.0.1, and the endpoint on the internet is 192.168.11 port 51820. And then after we do that, we can just ping one side and it works. And that was it. There was no like connect or it's just, no, we told it, here's the peer, and then they can talk to each other. And really that's it. There's nothing that much fancier to WireGuard. When we hit WG0 now, we see that the last time there was a handshake, that is this invisible stuff that's going on behind the scenes in WireGuard, was 5 seconds ago. The amount of transfer used for each, et cetera. So really, really kind of basic interface. Any questions about that?
You mentioned earlier that the IP address was optional for roaming. So if you go back to your example, does that mean on one of the hosts I can omit the 169 address?
Oh, 192.168, yeah, that's right.
Okay. Exactly. Oh, 192, so, sorry, yeah.
Yeah, so let's go through here. Blah, blah, blah. Yeah, so you see on the right side there, when we hit WG, we see that it has an endpoint.
Mm-hmm.
If there just wasn't an endpoint there, if peer A then pinged peer B, the endpoint would just appear.
Okay, cool.
So if peer, and so yeah, that's nice, because if peer A then changes IP addresses or connections or whatever, then peer B will just learn it the next time it connects.
Okay, cool, thanks.
Yeah. Okay. You saw this WG tool in the demo, which is just a very simple tool that works with IP. And these are kind of basic building block tools, and you can make more complicated things on top of that interface. At some point, hopefully WG will be actually folded into IP, just like many other things with the Linux kernel networking stack. So with these basic building blocks, you can make complex things on top of them. So it's been integrated into IF Updown from Debian, into OpenWRT and Leeds, networking configuration language. There's a Luchi module for that. In OpenRC, NetF IFRC has it. NixOS has it integrated into their crazy functional configuration system. Systemd, NetworkD, there's a work in progress for integrating it directly into that. And even Network Manager, of all things, is there's work in progress for integrating it directly into Network Manager. So for kind of desktop users or server users in particular environments, you can use the WG and IP tools, but if you want to set it up at a higher level, there are tons of easy integrations there.
Did you need to make changes to the IP utils or IP route 2?
Yeah, so when WG is merged into IP route 2, you will. I mean, it'll be the new version of it, I guess. But for now, WG is a separate utility.
So you currently have a small patch so that it understands the network type?
No, not at all. Right now, it's completely separate. IP is one utility that I don't touch, and WG is another utility that's part of WireGuard.
Oh, I see.
And so WG kind of has a syntax that's very familiar to people who use IP.
Oh, I see.
And so I'm hoping after WireGuard is in mainline Linux, then WG will just naturally become part of IP route 2. Right now, it's a separate tool, but later, I think it'll
In order to create the link, you had to say you wanted to create a link of type WireGuard.
That's just part of Linux. You don't need any patch for that.
Module
names.
Okay. Yeah, when you say IP link add WG0 type WireGuard, IP route is creating a netlink message with the string WireGuard in it. And then kernel says, are there any modules that support the type WireGuard? And if there aren't, then it asks user space to load a module that will have it. And then it asks you, okay, are there any modules that have it?
Yeah, the IP root source code is a bit opaque.
Sure. But anyway,
I never looked at that particular part, but thanks.
Right. Yeah. So anyway, it works now without any changes at all. And there are distro packages for all this. So you just kind of apt-get WireGuard and it works. There's also WG Quick. So WG does support configuration syntax for the WireGuard specific things, but WG Quick adds a couple extra keys to that configuration format, like address, post up, and post down, and just kind of adds some nice things. So you can make a VPN connection that has an allowed IP of 0.0.0.0/0, so that is, I want this VPN to handle all internet traffic for me. And then when you want to turn on WG Quick up VPN 0, WG Quick down VPN 0 to turn on and off. And this is actually a totally dumb bash script, nothing fancy about it, but it was really easy to write and easy to understand because it uses these composable tools, and you can just kind of fire up a WireGuard tunnel really easily. So WG Quick is one thing you can use if you're not using integration into the NetworkD or Network Manager, or you don't want to roll it yourself, you can use this. So because this is the Docker security interest group, I figure we'll talk about some network namespace tricks that you can do with WireGuard. So as you saw, WireGuard just gives you a normal interface. And network interfaces on Linux can live in different namespaces. So this is essentially how Docker does networking, is you put a virtual Ethernet interface in Docker container that has its own network namespace. And the other end of that happens to be in the host, and then they communicate and maybe they do masquerading or port forwarding or whatever. WireGuard has something similar to this, where the WireGuard interface itself can be in one namespace, and the socket that's sending the encrypted UDP packets can live in another namespace. So one thing you could do with this is you could give a Docker container as its only interface WG0. So the only way Docker then can access the internet would be through the WG0 interface. Which assures that all the traffic in Docker container is encrypted and authenticated, et cetera, with no way of leaking. Another way to set this up would be you could only let your DHCP client touch the physical interfaces, like ETH0 and WLAN0, but then only let your web browser see the WireGuard interfaces. So again, you have kind of a stronger security guarantee about the leakage, where the web browser isn't going to leak any traffic through some other interface because the only one it knows about is the WireGuard interface. So this is kind of a nice alternative to hacking up your routing table or using policy routing or the various tricks used before. So here's roughly what the Docker example would look like. You have WG0 in the container namespace, ping makes a clear text ping, then WireGuard encrypts that ping in UDP, but the UDP socket is actually in the init namespace, and so that encrypted traffic goes out through ETH0 or WLAN0. And then of course the opposite happens for this web browser kind of personal VPN example, where ping is in the init namespace alongside your browser and everything else. But then you move ETH0 and WLAN0 into a containerized namespace, to the physical namespace that actually has the UDP socket. Any questions on that? Nope. Okay. Yikes, hold on a second. Okay. Weird, I'm getting some strange feedback in my headset. Can someone say something that they can hear me, that this is actually working on your end still?
Oh yeah, definitely hearing you.
Okay, good. Sorry about that. I don't know what's going on. Okay, so the timer interface. So I mentioned that WireGuard appears stateless to the administrator. But then behind the scenes, there's all these things happening to ensure that there's a cryptographic session and a connection and all the rest. So this works with a very simple set of timers. And we have a couple timers, and we've accounted for every transition in the state machine of the timers so that there's no undefined states and no undefined transition. So how does this work? When user space sends a packet, if there's been no session established in the last 2 minutes, then we send a handshake initiation message. If we don't get a handshake response to that initiation, after 5 seconds, we resend an initiation. Every time we have a successfully authenticated incoming packet, we set a timer for 10 seconds after. If we get another authenticated packet, we move that timer ahead so it's 10 seconds in the future. Then if this timer actually goes off, that is, if we haven't received, if we haven't sent anything in the last 10 seconds, then we send an empty encrypted packet. So this way we can have another timer that says, if we actually haven't received an authenticated incoming packet in the last 15 seconds, then we know that there's something wrong with the connection and we send a new handshake initiation. So what this means is that when both sides are sending packets, great, this session is on and it doesn't send any additional packets, it doesn't need to. If someone just sends you one packet and you don't have anything to reply, after 10 seconds, you'll send an empty packet. But then if there's nothing else to send after that, then nobody sends anything and it just goes to sleep. So it's not like it's chatty and up all the time. But then if you need to send data again, then you just start sending data again and it just works. And this has the nice property that if you're ever sending data, but the other side isn't receiving it, computer's turned off or there's something wrong, WireGuard will very quickly figure this out and try and initialize a new handshake or try and reconnect or look for endpoints, et cetera. So this way the interface for user space sending packets is just send a packet, receive a packet, and doesn't need to know at all about the state. WireGuard is programmed with the defense in depth programming technique. So all the state required for WireGuard to work is allocated during the configuration. So we avoid dynamic memory allocation in response to receive packets. So by getting rid of dynamic allocations, we just eliminate a whole class of vulnerabilities. We just don't have them. And likewise, all the packet headers have fixed width fields, so you don't need a parser because you just have offsets for things that have a constant length and constant offset, and so you don't parse. And so with no parser, we have by definition no parser vulns. So whole class of vulnerabilities gone. And then on the logical level, we don't modify any state in response to an unauthenticated packet. So again, this gets rid of another whole class of vulnerabilities. So as I mentioned earlier, some aspects of WireGuard grew out of a kernel rootkit project. So being stealthy is really important. So it never responds to an unauthenticated packet. So you can't scan for a WireGuard instance. If you know about it and you have a correct private key that you control, then you can start talking to it. But if you don't have the right key, there's just no way you can determine that there's even a WireGuard endpoint there. So it's really stealthy. And as I mentioned before with the timers, it's not chatty at all. When there's no data that needs to be sent, the peers don't send anything. And then once they want to do send data, then they can start talking again. So it doesn't need kind of a persistent chatty protocol going on. Okay, so I'm about to get into the crypto, but any questions about the general concepts before I go into that?
Yeah, I have a question about, you said the previous slide, where you said you had pre-allocated fixed size packets, as I understand. What happens if you have a bigger MTU?
The Linux kernel networking stack has all sorts of drivers for Ethernet cards and wireless cards and so forth. And the way this generally works is a packet comes in on an Ethernet card, generates an interrupt. Sometime later, the Linux kernel will service that interrupt and will make a socket buffer that then corresponds to the physical memory on the Ethernet card. Now, all this is just part of core Linux kernel networking stack of how it gets packets off of an Ethernet card. And WireGuard has nothing to do with that at all. What WireGuard gets then is this this address region from the Ethernet card. And maybe it's been fixed up or reallocated or copied, or maybe it's still in the memory of the Ethernet card. But in any case, WireGuard just gets an address of, okay, here's the packet that it got. So from WireGuard's perspective, all it's doing is saying, well, here's a big chunk of memory. Does this chunk of memory authenticate correctly? So we don't actually need to allocate any memory. When we do decrypt that packet, we decrypt it in place. So we use the same memory that it came on to decrypt it. And this has nice performance characteristics too, because we don't have to allocate and copy. We can just decrypt in place. Does that answer the question?
Yes, it does. So how big is the overhead? You said it was UDP package that comes in. So yep. So if you have your Ethernet interface has 1500 MTU, what will the MTU be on the WireGuard interface?
Yeah, so the overhead is the UDP header and a new IP header, right, because of encapsulation, plus the WireGuard header, which is super small. And in total, this comes out to 60 bytes of overhead.
Right, so the WG0 interface is 60 bytes smaller than the 1500 then?
That's right, it has an MTU of 1440. Or if you're using IPv6, then 1420 because the V6 header is bigger.
That answers the question, thanks.
Okay.
Question, yeah. You have two slides ago, you talked about the timeouts, and then here you're saying, in that slide, you said there's no traffic when the things are not chatting.
But that's right.
The bottom point, you resend a handshake after nothing is authenticated for 15 seconds.
That's right. So here's what's going on. If I send you a ping packet and then you send me a ping back, then everything is fine. Then I've sent you a packet, you've sent one back to me, and so I know that my initial one made it to you. But if I send you, instead of a ping, just a one-way packet, just a UDP blob that doesn't warrant any response, I send this to you, then I don't have any way of knowing that you actually got that and you're alive. So So if you don't actually have anything to send back to me within 10 seconds, then you send to me an empty packet. And that way I know, okay, you're alive. But if I've sent something to you and I don't get anything back, either a normal packet or this empty packet, after 15 seconds, then I know that you're probably not alive. And so I send a handshake initiation. But in the first place, if I'm not sending you any data, then I'm not going to enter this logic where I have to receive apply from you. So this only happens if I've sent something from you. I'm expecting you to get something back.
I see. Thanks.
Okay. Okay, anything else, or should I keep going? All right, I shall keep going. Okay, the crypto. So for the crypto, we're using the noise protocol framework, which has been around for a while now. It's gotten a lot of feedback during the WireGuard development. And we have a particular implementation of the noise IK handshake. So we'll go into that. So it has the usual list of good properties you'd want from authenticated key exchange, is identity hiding, forward security, indistinguishability, resistance to key compromise impersonation, unknown key share attack, kind of all the laundry list of good things you'd want from a modern key exchange. And we use modern primitives, 255.19 for elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman, Blank2S for hashing, SHA-20, Poly-1305 for authenticated encryption, and we use SIPHASH-24 for our hash tables. Importantly, there's a lack of cipher agility. This might be controversial, but actually the WireGuard attitude is that if these primitives ever break, then you should update your systems to use primitives that aren't broken, and you shouldn't connect systems that have insecure crypto to systems that have secure crypto, because then the whole system is insecure, right? So it's this kind of terrible wisdom from the 90s that let's allow for the cipher agility, and then we'll throw on our network the stuff that's broken and stuff that's fixed. Well, that means kind of in whole that things are broken. So the idea here is I've picked primitives that are good, and if they're ever not good, then you'll update. And there's certainly good avenues and mechanisms for updating instances, but this is very different from having cipher agility and cipher negotiation. That really are just kind of old concepts that don't belong in the protocol. Any comments or objections to this before I keep going? Nope. Okay. Great. Wow. Unusual. Usually someone gets upset about this. Oh, okay. So there's for key secrecy, there's perfect for secrecy. So there's a new session key every 2 minutes. So we're an adversary to seize your computer and freeze the RAM in like dry ice or something, and later decrypt it. They'd only be able to get the last 2 minutes of traffic. So keys are kind of constantly generated and then erased from memory. Key agreement properties, there's good authenticity. There's key compromise impersonation resistance. So this means that if someone steals your public key, they can't then impersonate somebody else to you. There's a lot of protocols that are vulnerable to this. There's identity hiding. So you never actually transmit your public key in clear text over the wire. So if you're just eavesdropping on the wire, you can't even figure out who's talking to each other. Networks reorder packets. This is what networks do. So we have to allow reordering, but we have things in place to prevent a replay attack. So we have a mechanism with a sliding window and so forth. Been working with Kevin Milner from Oxford on a formal verification using Tamarin. So the paper on this was just published a couple days ago. And now it turns out that all the crypto I'm about to explain to you is provably secure. So the next slides now I'm certain are not nonsense, whereas before I guess there's some chance that it was just rubbish. But no more. Okay, so the key exchange is one round trip. There's a message from initiator to responder, and then responder back to initiator. After this, both sides do some calculations to get the symmetric keys for their session, and then they can start exchanging transport data of the actual packets they want to encrypt. So in order for them to exchange data, they first have to derive the ephemeral keys. That's what gives the port secrecy. And the whole key exchange is designed to follow the principles before that we set out, where we don't want static allocations, we want the state to be guarded, fixed length headers, and there needs to be stealthiness. And because of this timer system, it means that each side can reinitiate the handshake with the other side at any point. So initiator and responder can swap roles. This means there's no concept of server and client. It's just you have a peer and another peer. And because it's one round trip and not one and a half round trip or something more complicated, initiator and responder can just swap. They can turn the whole handshake around and do things the other way and come to the same result. And importantly, invalid handshake messages are ignored, not replied to, maintaining stealth. So if you send some bogus values, you won't get a message back saying your values are bogus. You just won't get anything back. So you can't even figure out that there was anyone there. Okay, so let's see, on the time, we only have 10 minutes, so I might kind of breeze through this fast. So one peer is initiator, the other is responder. Each peer has their static long-term identity. This is their static key pair. This is what we generated with WG GenKey in the beginning. And both sides exchange this in this SSH authenticated keys model. But then for each new handshake, WireGuard automatically generates a random new ephemeral key pair. And so the security properties we want, we get by essentially hashing together the results of four Diffie-Hellman operations. So we multiply the points together for ephemeral static, static ephemeral, ephemeral ephemeral. So those first three make up the so-called triple Diffie-Hellman that's well known from the signal protocol. But then we add in there a static static, which allows us to have authentication in the first message. Okay, we can skip this. There's strong key secrecy, there's good uniqueness, identity hiding. I mentioned before, we've now formally verified things. So, in the first message, there's a couple parts. There's the clear text of the ephemeral public key, and then the initiator's public key is encrypted using the result of a Diffie-Hellman calculation of the initiator's ephemeral and the responder's static. And then we have a monotonic counter, usually a timestamp, to avoid replay attack on the packet. And this adds in, again, the static-static Diffie-Hellman. The message from responder back to initiator adds two more of the Diffie-Hellman calculations. But first it gives the clear text ephemeral public key of the responder, and then it authenticate encrypts an empty buffer. So it just authenticates an empty buffer using some result of the two remaining Diffie-Hellman calculations of ephemeral ephemeral and ephemeral static. After they exchange these, they can start talking to each other. The initiator always has to send the first transport information so that it confirms the reception of the responder's message. Okay, so that might have been a bit fast to really do it justice, but if you have questions, I guess you can find me after and we can go through it more slowly if you like. But the important thing to take away is that it's just one round trip. It's really super simple to implement. There's not 1,000 messages. There's not some crazy record layer, no certificates, no AES-1. And the amount of code for the whole key exchange is 441 lines of code. Compared to Strong Swan, which is doing IPsec key exchange, which is like 400,000 lines of code. It's like 400 lines of code. So really basic, but now it's been formally verified to have all these great security properties. So I think this is a real strength here where you can have good crypto, but with a simple implementation so you don't have vulnerabilities. There's also kind of a poor man's post-quantum resistance. There are all these post-quantum secure primitives that are coming out and the research that's going on. But in my opinion, it's all a bit new to put into a kind of a long-term protocol now. And hopefully in a couple of years, we'll have something. But I think right now, we're not ready to make the plunge there. So the poor man's version comes from this guy, Grover, who figured out that with a quantum computer, you can brute force a symmetric key in with a square root speed up. So a 256-bit symmetric key that becomes as secure as a 128-bit symmetric key. And not only did he show that you can make this with a quantum computer, which is a nice attack, importantly, he showed that this attack is an optimal attack, that you can't do better than this with a quantum computer. So if you're using a 128-bit key, splitting this in half to 64 bits is catastrophic. But if you use a 256-bit symmetric key, splitting this in half to 128 bits is okay, is secure. That's sufficiently big even with a quantum computer. So optionally, two peers can have a pre-shared symmetric key. And the idea here is that hopefully these are hard to steal, or they've been exchanged through some extra secure mechanism, maybe within a secure network, before things are connected through an insecure network, or whatever the case is. But it adds this additional layer of post-quantum resistance. The reason you might want this is not because people necessarily have quantum computers now, but because it's possible that your traffic is being recorded now. And when there is a quantum computer, maybe your past traffic could then be decrypted. So if you don't want that to happen, you use these pre-shared symmetric keys, and hopefully by the time there's a quantum computer, the world's kind of forgotten about the symmetric keys. These hard drives don't really work anymore. It's done with, so there's not really much of a chance of recovering them. And your past traffic can't be decrypted. There's very strong denial of service resistance. So it turns out that hashing and symmetric crypto is fast, but public key crypto is slow. And even 255.19, that's supposed to be really fast, is still slower than sending a DOS attack over the network. So there's a vuln in OpenVPN where you can just basically make OpenVPN do a bunch of RSA calculations and DOS OpenVPN. Doesn't have this built in. So WireGuard uses a cookie mechanism to prevent against DOS attacks. So let's see, how am I doing on time? Oh boy, 4 minutes. Okay, I'm afraid we'll have to skip this, but there's a nice cookie mechanism that builds on the work from TCP, builds on the work from DTLS and IKEv2. Is unlike host identity protocol in Bitcoin, but this was considered. And instead, there's a WireGuard solution that's kind of better and more robust than the rest. It uses a nice PRF construction. Getting to the end, the performance winds up being really good. Because it's in the kernel, it means it's fast and super low latency because we don't have to copy packets back and forth between user space and kernel space a million times. ChaCha 20 poly 1-5, the authenticated encryption we're using, is fast on all hardware. AES NI is fast too, but only on hardware that supports it, one. And two, as the vector instructions like AVX on Intel processors get wider and wider, it seems that ChaCha is actually competitive with AES NI. And if you don't have special AES instructions, not only is AES slower, but it's really hard to implement securely without cache timing attacks. Whereas ChaCha can be implemented efficiently and securely on pretty much all processors. It's really basic. And in general, it's fast because it's the thing is simple. I mean, less code, a faster program. Well, obviously not always, but in this case, it's definitely what's going on here. So compared to the competition, it wins in all categories. And so less than 4,000 lines of code, easily implemented. The design lends itself to good, secure coding patterns. It's super stealthy, uses modern crypto, and general design of it's opinionated, but hopefully in a good way. Okay, so that's it. Any questions, guys? All right, well, I guess I'll turn it back over to you.
I have a question.
Okay.
First of all, thanks very much for the presentation. It was really good, really useful. And WireGuard seems, I tried setting up IPsec before and it was like an absolute nightmare.
Yeah, it's horrible.
It got simpler. Could you give an update on the status of, have you tried upstreaming into the kernel? If so, what were the responses to it?
So the upstream kernel guys like Dave Miller and people on NetDev, they're definitely aware of WireGuard, and I think they're into the idea. I haven't submitted a V1 patch because there's currently some things to be done before it's upstream. I need to move to using NetLink from Ioctl. So that's just a matter of coding it. But more importantly, I need to fix the kernel's crypto API. If you want to encrypt something in the Linux kernel right now, you have to like dynamically allocate a bunch of crazy structures per decryption, per key. It's just a slow, clunky, horrible thing. And I refuse to use an API that bad. So basically, I've been taking parts of WireGuard that are different from the Linux kernel and upstreaming them in pieces. And so the crypto API stuff is kind of the last big piece that I need to upstream. But there's some work recently on the random number generator and blocking and all that. That's upstream now. And so bit by bit, the things that WireGuard needs are going to be put upstream. And then by the time it comes for WireGuard to be merged, there'll be nothing funky or different about it. It'll just be this kind of self-contained thing that integrates with the rest. And I think it'll be pretty uncontroversial.
Mm-hmm. Good. And how, from a maturity level, how mature would you make it at the moment?
Officially, I'm still calling it experimental because I like the ability to break it still. But in fact, it's pretty damn stable at the moment. I'm running this in production on my machines. I know a bunch of other people are.
Okay.
It works well. There aren't huge vulns, but officially it is experimental, and there might still be vulns and there might still be breakages. So if you're looking for something with like super strong public guarantees on the implementation, you should wait. I think if you'd like to try it now, it's not going to hurt you.
Yeah, no, so I'm mostly asking, so we, Riaz and Justin and I had sort of discussed in the past that we should just include WireGuard as default in the LinuxKit kernel.
So that's a different issue, actually. So if you don't add a WireGuard interface, it's not...
To use it and develop software around it much easier because then it's just there.
Right. Yeah, so that's not a problem at all, even though it's experimental, because it's a module. So if you don't turn it on, if you don't add a WG0 interface, there's no WireGuard code that's going to run. I think in LinuxKit it really should move into the default kernel. I'm gonna look into that this week. Right now, there's a it's in a project and there's a patch for it.
Yeah, I saw that. I merged your update earlier today.
Oh, okay. That was you who merged it. Okay, sorry. Yeah. I have no idea who's talking to me right now.
I'm sorry. You've maybe done introductions.
Okay. Cool. So, yeah. Okay, great. So, yeah, expect to get a patch from me soon that puts into the default kernel.
I mean, I mean Riaz or Justin, would you have any objections if we include it?
No, that would be good.
So I have a related question. And hi, I'm Nathaniel, and I work on Alpine Linux.
Ah, okay, cool.
So if I currently we have the WireGuard as a separate package in the testing repository because we don't want to support it for some time. But what do you think about making a release that has long time support?
If you're willing to update the packages in that release, sure. I think freezing the packages at some snapshot really isn't okay, but if you want to keep updating those, it's fine. I mean, usually the updates for WireGuard snapshots involve just changing the date in the package build file, so an APK build file in your case.
Yeah, and when it comes to stability, how likely is it that a future version will not work together with older versions and that? Is it stable in that matter, or are you breaking things so next update you have to upgrade everywhere?
So I've broken the protocol twice in the past, and I really, really, really hope that the last breakage is it, especially since... I've just expended all this effort to formally verify the protocol. I'm now even more reluctant to change it because now it's this thing. So at this point, I still want to reserve the right to change the protocol if I need to, if there's a super compelling reason. But I'm having trouble imagining that actually happening. But in any case, if you're going to be updating the packages for those releases anyway, then you'll get any possible protocol updates anyway. So
yes, but the thing is, we make a stable release and we have a stable release branch, and then we cannot make breaking changes within that. So then we will have to backport security fixes and that kind of things. And that's, I'm not very interested in doing. So that's why I would like
upstream
to provide a stable branch that you will provide security patches if ever needed.
That makes sense. So while it's still a snapshot and not an upstream Linux, you should just treat every commit as a security patch, even if it's not. So like right now, treat the project as a rolling thing. I make snapshots usually every 2 weeks, sometimes every 3 weeks, that I think are kind of stable snapshots in time of how it is. And when those come out, you really should update to the next one.
Yeah. Do you have an idea when you will make a stable release of it? When you will?
I'm hoping around end of the year, that should be set.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Sure. Any other questions?
Not a question, but Jason, that was a really awesome presentation. So thank you for going through WireGuard and all the different crypto and usability and aspects of it. That was really interesting.
Probably liked it.
Questions for Jason?
Well, I guess I'll turn it back to you then.
Sure. Don't have anything else substantial. We got a couple of minutes, but just want to quickly just share this slide. We meet every 2 weeks, so the next time we'll be meeting is August 2nd. Agenda is still TBD, but if you have any topics you'd like to cover or if anyone has any ideas, please feel free to reach out to me, as well as reach out to me if you have any feedback for the meeting and ways that we can improve. So I want to just thanks everyone for coming. Thank you again, Jason, for the excellent presentation, and looking forward to seeing folks next time. So see ya.
Cool. See you guys.
Thanks.